Hi everyone, my name is Jenna McNeill and I'm a pulmonary critical care attending at Massachusetts General Hospital. And today we'll be discussing treating pulmonary hypertension. The key takeaways for today are to understand potential therapies for pulmonary hypertension treatment and to understand the role of tertiary centers for pulmonary hypertension evaluation. When you think about the treatment of pulmonary hypertension, the etiology driving the pulmonary hypertension is key. Therefore, we will think of treatment based upon the World Health Organization criteria. So first, we'll talk about understanding when to start potential treatment for group 1, or pulmonary arterial hypertension, which depends on symptoms. So for example, utilizing the World Health Organization criteria based upon functional class, it's helpful to understand the symptoms that are occurring in the activity of daily life. So for example, someone who is class 2 has mild symptoms such as mild shortness of breath or slight limitations during ordinary activity. However, someone in class 4 has severe limitations even at rest. We take these WHO classes and we further risk stratify people into low, intermediate, or high. So for example, those in the high risk category will have more evidence of advanced disease and more limitation with activity. In addition, they will have higher lab values, such as right atrial pressure, suggesting volume overload, and a lower cardiac index, demonstrating worse cardiac function. When we think about pulmonary arterial hypertension, we would confirm this diagnosis with a right heart catheterization. At the time of right heart catheterization, we would also perform something called vasoreactivity testing, which is typically performed by giving the patient a pulmonary vasodilator. So, for example, inhaled nitric oxide, and we would monitor their hemodynamics. So, someone who has a positive vasoreactivity test would have evidence of reduction in their mean pulmonary artery pressure by greater than 10 to a value less than 40 millimeters of mercury with an improvement or stability in their cardiac output. Even though we perform this testing in individuals undergoing right heart catheterization, only 10% of patients meet the criteria for being vasoreactive. And as you would see in this figure, if they were vasoreactive, they would then be potential candidates for calcium channel blocker therapy. But let's say your patient does not show evidence of vasoreactivity. What would be the next steps for potential therapy? If we have a patient, for example, who is intermediate risk with underlying pulmonary arterial hypertension, there are many potential therapies that can target the pathogenesis of the disease. There are 14 approved medications based upon different mechanisms of drivers for pulmonary hypertension. And these medications have been demonstrated to improve functional status for patients with pulmonary arterial hypertension. The recommendation for patients that are intermediate risk is initially upfront dual combination therapy. This would be defined as using medications from, for example, two different classes of those in bold for therapy for pulmonary arterial hypertension. This recommendation, so for example, a combination of ambrisentan and tadalafil, came out of the AMBITION trial, which demonstrated that those who received combination therapy in comparison to monotherapy of either one of these medications had improvement in their functional status. Therefore, the current recommendation for those who are intermediate risk is to use upfront dual therapy for those who have been diagnosed with pulmonary arterial hypertension. In addition to starting therapy, followed by a repeat right heart catheterization to monitor hemodynamics, there should also be a discussion with patients regarding pulmonary rehabilitation or physical therapy, avoidance of pregnancy, given they are at high risk for complications, avoiding low oxygen levels, which would be defined as less than 88%, as low oxygen levels or hypoxemia can cause increases in pulmonary vascular resistance, infection prevention, as well as making sure that patients have good psychosocial support. We initially discussed group 1, or pulmonary arterial hypertension, and now we are going to move on to group 2, which is left-sided heart disease, which remains the most common driver for pulmonary hypertension. So post-capillary pulmonary hypertension, or that being driven by left heart disease, should be optimized by assessing volume status via physical exam or potentially right heart catheterization. When patients have evidence of volume overload, diuretics should be used to maintain a low pulmonary capillary wedge pressure. In addition, if valvular disease is the driver for the left-sided disease, surgery should be considered to correct the cardiac function, which is driving the formation of post-capillary pulmonary hypertension. Next, we are going to move on to group 3, which is pulmonary hypertension that is caused by hypoxia or lung disease on right heart catheterization. Typically, therapy has been focused on optimizing the lung disease or correcting the hypoxia. However, recently, studies have demonstrated that those with underlying interstitial lung disease who were given inhaled Tyvaso as a therapy had an increase in 6-minute walk distance. Therefore, now patients with underlying interstitial lung disease who have evidence of pulmonary hypertension are typically being referred to tertiary centers for the consideration of inhaled Tyvaso as a therapy that may be beneficial to improve 6-minute walk distance or functional status for those with underlying lung disease, while in addition confirming and making sure that their lung disease is treated to the best of their ability. Next, we are going to move on to group 4. Sometimes people refer to this as CTEF. This can typically be diagnosed via ventilation perfusion scan or a VQ scan. If there is suggestion of pulmonary hypertension on echocardiogram or right heart catheterization, along with a VQ scan that is suggestive of perfusion defects, this should warrant referral to a tertiary center for pulmonary angiogram. In these patients, if there is evidence of central obstruction or central clot, these patients may be good candidates for surgical pulmonary endarterectomy, which can actually be curative of their underlying pulmonary hypertension. For those who had evidence of peripheral disease, balloon angioplasty or riociguat can be helpful. Riociguat is a medication also used for group 1 disease. However, when it has been used in patients that have underlying CTEF, there has been demonstrated improvement in 6-minute walk distance. Again, this medication is typically used for those that are deemed to not be surgical candidates, but still have evidence of pulmonary hypertension, as well as evidence of chronic thrombolic disease on either VQ scan or other imaging modalities. Thank you for watching. I hope you found this topic helpful.